You can sit right here, or you can sit wherever you want, and then you can present from wherever you want, but to move your slides, you're going to have to be up there. We broadcast on Facebook. We have like 10 people that watch it, and
some
that are shut-ins. And then I always post it on YouTube if you want to, if anybody else would like to see it.
Yes, my boss would like to.
Okay, because I'll give you the address. It's First Universalist in Madison. Nobody's ever watched anything I put on YouTube, but we have some people that hate Facebook. They think it's an invasion of privacy. So I said, well, I'll put it on YouTube. And you can go look at it on YouTube, which they never do, but it's there if they want to.
Well, I looked at YouTube.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, okay. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Well, then you see pretty much how we do it here. So.
Yeah, I love your, what's with the visual there?
I'm kind of big on graphics, so that's, we're talking about basically generic pollution. So that's just a generic pollution global warming thing that I
do. Oh, okay, okay.
I'll show you the rest of my slides.
Oh, okay. So.
And I basically do one children's story, and I do like story hours, which is 3D.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
And I do children's story with an hour.
Oh, okay.
Right, I know that.
This is the children's story.
And then I put this up just because you're talking about Yes.
I was like, I know that guy.
Yes.
Let's see. I'm going to take this one down there. People need to have some handouts.
Let's see. Are you playing the postman?
Yes. Yes.
Just tell me when we get it.
Oh, okay.
Good morning and welcome to First Universalist of New Madison. On this beautiful fall day, we're a little discombobulated because we have a special speaker today, Virginia McNeil from Virginia.
West Virginia.
West Virginia. Yeah, we don't want to screw up West Virginia and Virginia.
No, we don't.
Do you want to do the introduction now or do you want to wait till she comes up?
Oh, either way.
Let's do it now.
Okay.
Mike's going to give us a little introduction because Virginia has been here in the past, like years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Before I came, but everybody else, a lot of people, if you've been here, you'll know who Virginia is, so that would be kind of a refresher introduction.
It's my pleasure to introduce Virginia. We chatted a number of times over the telephone and internet and whatever, but we had the most wonderful lunch yesterday at Gallows, and we talked about, I wish we would have recorded it, Jenny, because we talked about everything A to Z, from politics to the miracles and biochemistry of fungus. Okay, I mean, we covered everything, and we had a wonderful time. And those of you who know me well, I was just in glory. I
mean,
I'm here to hear. Anyway, Jenny is a retired public health nurse. I'm going to read you a few of her interesting parts of her background. An active environmentalist and community educator concerned with the health effects of environmental toxins. She holds a master's degree in public health nursing from the University of North Carolina and a BS in health and community education from the University of Cincinnati. She began her career as a public and school health nurse. We talked a lot about that. We have common background in schools. I've been in schools many years, as well as Jim being in school with schools many years. And there are certainly unique challenges in working with public health in schools today. Also a nurse educator at the university level. She's worked also as a research assistant in environmental and occupational health studies. She served as a specialist in community education, programming that promotes empowerment of communities, empowerment to address environmental concerns and threats is the word she wrote specifically. Jenny's a board member of FACT Ohio. She serves as a committee member for the Bryan Education Committee, as well as a member of the planning team for Unitarian Universalist Justice Ohio, dealing with environmental injustices in Ohio, and a member of the Green Sanctuary Committee of the First Universalist Unitarian Universalist Society of Marietta, Ohio. So basically, her concern with fracking waste injection wells in Washington County and Southeast Ohio. She's going to be telling us more about that. She's provided public education presentations about the risk and mitigation of radioactive brine spreading for the Buckeye, actually spreading for the Buckeye Environmental Network Brine Task Force. And Jenny believes that knowledge is power, and the knowledgeable communications can create healthy futures for thriving families, for safe economies. Let's welcome Jenny.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
You want to do it now or you want to do it later in the service?
No, that's
it makes
fine.
No difference to us.
You
want to, just continue with it?
No.
Yeah. Because our hands
well,
are...
Yeah, we'll do it.
Okay.
We'll do it when we get...
Perfect.
When we get to the...
Okay, Jenny's going to be talking on pollution, generally fracking and spreading of brine and on the roads. So this is my little presentation picture on pollution. You know that I'm hot for that. So you're going to see reviews of that multiple times. Okay, let's start with the prelude. I guess Mike has to come up again. We're doing How Great Thou Art. With the spoken word, which we really enjoy hearing.
And may I interject very quickly as well, before we have our wonderful prelude, that I neglected to say, remember as announcement-wise, Lou is still collecting the coats, and he will be for next week and the week after, okay? And we got a note from him this week, he's making great progress, and the coats again will, and mittens, hats, will go to Ukrainian relief, and they will actually go through on their way to Ukraine, through a church in Galloway, Ohio, which we made connections with. So,
question about that, Mike.
Yes.
I understand we're also taking up a special collection for Ukraine.
Yes.
That's separate, related.
We're going to be doing that, I guess, next week on the 30th.
Next week.
Yes, and it will. It's directly that cash will go right along to the Galloway Church or in its way to Ukraine.
Good. I didn't want to miss it, and I didn't know the next day yet.
Thank you for asking.
Okay. Anybody that is watching on YouTube or Facebook, you can always put an envelope under the door, or there is a site on the website where you can make a donation. I'm not sure how that works, but I've been informed that it does work.
It does.
So,
it does.
We have any other announcements? I missed that part. All right.
Announcement.
Yes.
We have today with us Melissa Van Dyke. She's a candidate for vice representative.
State representative. House of Representatives.
And importantly, she is a write-in candidate. So, do you have any more signs?
I have one sign.
One
All
sign.
My signs should be done by Tuesday or Wednesday.
All right, if you have more signs, let me know. I'm putting signs out. Melissa's from Wayne Lakes, and I have a property at Wayne Lakes, so we've kind of met there before. But that's the trouble we're having is if you look at, I have a Preble County, and I got my... my mail-in ballot, my absentee ballot, because I'm working at the polls this year, and I'm working in a poll that's not mine, so I can't vote during the poll. There are probably six or seven county and state offices that have no Democrats running, or no, all they have is a Republican, let me put it that way.
Mm-hmm.
We need to give people a choice. Sometimes it can be difficult, people will give you a hard time, but we need to put our names up for a choice, or someone's name up for a choice. So I salute Melissa for letting us write her name in, but it has to be written in, and we will spell it for you so you'll know how to spell it. And I'm sure we'll have handouts too.
Okay.
And cards.
Yeah. And cards. Any additional announcements? Well, then let's begin our worship service and sacred time together. Thank you.
We've had a kind of a hectic beginning, and it's going to be a hectic in the middle because we're changing all of our graphics and everything. So let's take a moment to center. Let us hold a quiet moment now as we light our chalice. Henry David Thoreau wrote in his journal in February 2nd, 1841, a child asked his father what became of the old moon. He said it was cut up into stars. Consider the light. Light out of darkness,
Light begets light. The light which the God of Genesis brought out of the darkness is the light that became our world. Our sun's light, reflecting off our moon, is eclipsed, but then returns to us as our earth quietly moves out of its way. In our current scientific understanding of the origins of the universe, the light of everything that exploded from not quite nothing is the light that became the maybe everything of which we are barely a part. The light we now kindle here will become a light for each of us to carry forth as we find our way through the shadows on our path. Let us be grateful for the light in our lives, even as we honor the dark from which the light came. Our opening hymn, Being a Morn Thy Music. Bring a Morn Thy Music, 39 in your hymnal. Blessed is the sky and all that is warm and filled with light. Blessed is the air and all that is open and free. Blessed is the earth and all that is steady and firm. Blessed is the sea and all that is hidden and deep. All right, as you see, we're doing our pollution thing, so we're continuing on that line with our children's story, which is story berries, which you know that I love. These are free, located on the internet.
The Night the Moon Went Missing by Shreya Yadav at Storyweaver. Late one night, when her Amma and Ashan were fast asleep, Marsha grabs her goggles and sneaks out of the house. Marsha loves the beach at night, and one of her best friends lives in the sea. My chef goes to their usual meeting place on the beach and calls out, "Ushli, are you here?" She can sit for hours watching Ushli fly in and out of the water. Ushli is a flying fish and loves to show off his tricks. But today, Ushli looks worried. "What's the matter?" Marsha asks. "Why do you look so upset?" "Can't you see?" he says. "The moon is missing." "The moon?" Ushli is right. Their friend is not in the sky tonight. In fact, there's a big hole where the moon should have been. "But we saw her just last night," Marsha exclaims. "She rose from the sea, right here in front of us. Do you think she's lost underwater?" "We have to find her," Ushli says. "But how do we see anything in that moonlight?" Marsha asks. Just then, Ushli notices something in the water. Every time a wave breaks in the distance, little sparks of light glow and fade and glow again. "Marsha," he shouts, excited, "I have an idea. Get on my back. Let's go to those waves over there." When they reach the lights, Marsha puts on her goggles, holds on to Ushli tightly, and Marsha gasps. She feels like she's floating in a sky full of stars. There are tiny creatures glowing all around her. "Wow, who are they?" she whispers to Ushli. "They're plankton. Maybe they can help us light our way in the sea," Ushli says. "Will you share your light with us?" Marsha asks one of them. "The moon is missing, and we need some light to find her." "You will need more than just my light," the plankton says. "Let me ask my friends if they can help too." Soon, Marsha and Ushli are joined by an army of little animals and their flickering lights. "Now where can the moon be?" Marsha wonders. "I can help you," a deep, booming voice says in Marsha's ear. She spins around. The eight tentacles of a firefly squid glimmer back at her. His body is covered in neon blue lights. "I saw the moon go this way just a little while ago." At first, Marsha is scared of the big tentacles, but she knows the firefly squid's light can help them see better underwater. "Lead the way," Marsha says. The squid wraps one of his tentacles around Marsha's finger. "Hold on tight." Then Marsha, Ushli, the glowing plankton, and the firefly squid all swim down together. Down, down, down they go, where the water is very dark. But the plankton grow brighter, and the squid flashes his light. There is still no moon in sight. Then they meet an anglerfish out on a hunt. She has big teeth, but Marsha is not scared anymore. "Hello," she says. "We're looking for the moon. Have you seen her around?" "Yes," says the anglerfish. "I saw her swimming with some moonfish a few hours ago. Follow me." Marsha, Ushli, the squid, and the plankton follow the green lure of the anglerfish. The light from the glowing animals falls like a spotlight on the dark ocean floor. Suddenly, Marsha sees something white under a rock. It's the moon. "Help," squeaks the moon. "I'm stuck." The squid lifts the rock with his tentacles. "Hurrah," everyone shouts as the pale moon slips out. "What happened?" Ushli asks. "I came here to meet my cousins, the moonfish," says the moon. "I got lost on my way back when my light began to fade, and then I got stuck under this rock. Thank you for coming to look for me." "So this is where you are when you're not in the sky," Marsha says. The moon smiles and begins to float up towards the surface. Finally, she jumps into the sky. Ushli and Marsha wave goodbye to their new friends and swim back to the beach in the moonlight. The stars under the sea continue to shine deep into the night. Meet the lightmakers. Did you know that many animals, both above and underwater, are able to make their own light? The tiny plankton that Marsha and Ushli meet glow to scare the animals that might eat them. When they sense movement in the water, the plankton let out bright sparks as a warning. Sometimes, waves and boat traffic also trigger this light. While planktonic animals have a chemical in them that helps them glow, the firefly squid has special organs called photophores that produce its light. Thousands of these light-producing photophores on the squid's body flash to attract food, or impress a mate, or confuse predators. The lures of anglerfish get their light from the glowing bacteria that live inside them. Many plants and animals glow above water too. Fireflies, some mushrooms, and even you emit a tiny amount of light every day. The end. Thank you for reading with storyberries.com.
The end. Wouldn't you like to meet a firefly squid? I think that would be one amazing sight. All right, joys and concerns. We want to raise, as we do every week, Ukraine. We have coats. There are already coats down in the basement. I see Lou has procured some. Feel free to bring in anything that you can find or donate or find at Goodwill or Salvation Army. They can be used, but they have to be clean and serviceable. We don't want to pass on junk. Yes?
Are we collecting next Sunday for help with the shipment?
I think that's where we are right now. We'll make a couple announcements and maybe send out an email blast ahead of time. Because actually, we need to get moving on that, or they won't get there in time for cold weather. So, any other announcements or any other joys and concerns?
Well, I think maybe a candle for the instability in Africa, the number of critical food shortages going on there now in different countries, but particularly around Chad, Somalia, and just another example of instability, but more importantly, the critical need for starving children. It seems to be a mantra of this day and age, and I think it takes that we all come forward and at least our thoughts and our support in those particular areas.
And I have one. My wife is the interim pastor at New Carlisle, and as happens to almost every church, we've experienced that here. Dissension starts as a little seed and grows and then becomes something that they have to take to the district. And people are upset, people's feelings are hurt, people strike out in fear, anger, I'm not sure exactly what. A difficult time for the life of the church and a difficult time for those who shepherd that church. If you keep my wife, Tara, in your hearts and minds while she struggles through and tries to keep a group together that maybe doesn't want to be together. We've all had experience with that too. Anything else? All right. For those joys, those concerns, those fears, those trepidations that you are unable to voice, unable maybe to recognize in your own mind, we are sharing those with you. We will share those with you. If you have problems that we can help with, please do not hesitate to bring those to us. All right, our message is with Virginia McNeil. I put up a little slide. She's going to be talking on this distribution on the snow plowing. I'm kind of a mechanical fiend, so what I'm showing you is the new snow plow trucks, and I'm sure you've all noticed it, but maybe never paid any attention. They now have a wing on the side. Instead of plowing the snow up on the berm of the road, the wing brings it over another 2 or 3 feet. Whoever thought of that idea is a genius. It's on the same truck, it doesn't cost much, and it doubles their plowing ability at one single stroke. All right, we're gonna change our computers. We're gonna put her computer on, so hopefully that will go smoothly.
Started my UU journey right here in this building. My children were about 5 years old. I have twin daughters, and I was looking for some sort of a spiritual home that I could help them embrace as well as me so that we could do this together. My husband decided not to be embraced spiritually. That's fine. I'm a recovering Catholic. So this was the best fit for me and my daughters. They are now in their 30s, still plugging in by Zoom, and UU communities in their area of Florida. So I am delighted to be back here. I was sharing with Mike that and Tim, but this was a nostalgic visit for me, truly was. We used to live in Richmond and moved to West Virginia about 15 years ago. So my spiritual home now is in Marietta, Ohio, and that's the closest UU community for my middle of nowhere home in West Virginia. So I travel about 3 hours to get there. I don't do it every week, but I do it as I can, as weather permits, as my energy level allows. So in the course of engaging with the Marietta UU community, I got involved with the Green Sanctuary Committee, and that was in my bio sketch. And through that, I got real concerned about water quality and the impact that the oil and gas development industry is having on water quality, land quality, air quality, and ended up getting involved in FACT Ohio, which is, let's see, is this me? Nope.
Yep, that's you.
Okay, let me back up a minute here. I wanted to share the initial slide. Faith Communities Together for a Sustainable Future. It's an interfaith group that's concerned about environmental integrity and creation care, which is the new kind of catchphrase for faith involvement in earth stewardship. Many faith traditions uniting to protect the earth, our mission, clean water, healthy soil, quick, safe, just transition to renewable energy sources and healthy living. You can go to our website, factohio.org. I think I put it on the little handout that you've got in front of you. I'm gonna ask you to be thinking as I'm sharing this information with you about what can I do, because I think UUs have a tendency to want to jump in and fix stuff, and I want you to jump in and fix stuff, okay? So be thinking about it, because I'm going to hold you to it, all right? I've got a little friend that I brought with me. His name, over here, Hot Rad. Pumpkin Rad, yeah, Hot Rad. He's a radioactive pumpkin. The state pumpkin of Ohio. Hot Rad, yeah. But I'm gonna ask you to provide me with an action that you can take, like when you leave here today, tonight, tomorrow, this week, this month, that helps move the dial, helps move the needle farther, closer to our mission. A healthy environment that's safe for all. And if you put that on a piece of paper, then I will have it documented. And then I can come back. I don't need your name. Don't need your name. If you would like to be part of our mailing list, I'll ask you to put your contact information on the little slip of paper in here. And when you do that, you can grab a Dove chocolate. Right? Yeah. Okay. Okay, I'll pass you out after we're done. So, in the course of getting involved with FACT Ohio and picking up the challenge of environmental justice in Ohio, I mean, I'm very committed to Ohio. My children were born here. I went to school here. I have lots of family that live around Ohio. And the idea that there's some sort of environmental threat that's being authorized by our state legislators was concerning to me. I mean, I don't have a vote in Ohio. I live in West Virginia, but I did have a vote at one time, and I can influence voters in Ohio, I think, with presentations like this. If you would like for this presentation to be provided to some organization that you're connected with, let me know. My contact information. And I would be glad to share it with you. So, all faith traditions have long recognized a spiritual responsibility for environmental stewardship. The Native Americans, who are probably the what I call the taproot to environmental justice in our world, felt that we are one with the earth, that the earth guides our thinking, and we guide the thinking of the earth. We're like this. From the Jewish tradition, I think that it was interesting, the Jewish tradition recognized how destructive people can be. So don't do that, okay? Don't destroy the earth, because there's not going to be anybody here that can repair it. Once it's done, it's you know, once it's cooked, it's done. From the Torah, the Bible, the Jewish and Christian traditions, that blend of faiths, the Lord took man, humans, and put him in the Garden of Eden to till and to keep. So there was an expectation from God that we have that we preserve the earth, that we steward it. From the Muslim tradition, they believed in guardianship, or what they called khalifa, of the planet, and that was to balance exploitation. Well, not really balance it, but to counter exploitation. So guardianship is an important component of the Muslim tradition relative to earth stewardship. From the Buddhist tradition, the Dalai Lama says that humans should care to secure their future. So they have a very forward-looking position that what we do today influences what happens tomorrow, what happens to our children, what happens to our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, into the future. Our program addresses six components. I'm going to speak more specifically on health effects, because I think that's something that most people can connect to right away. They feel environmental pollution is a health threat, and some people actually have symptoms, asthma, skin conditions, neurological problems from environmental pollution. So we're gonna focus on health effects today, as well as some of the policy issues, the laws and regulations. Because if you can affect the policy of a practice that affects the people, then you've really gone upstream with your stewardship. You've really gotten to the beginning of where it all happens at the policy level. And that's with your legislators and your local commissioners, your mayor, as well as your representatives in the state house. So, as well as the federal EPA. This infographic is an interesting picture of what happens with radioactive brine, which is what we're talking about. Brine waste from oil and gas production is a radioactive substance. It contains two radioactive isotopes, radium-226 and radium-228. And we'll talk about a little bit more about what those things do. But they're produced when there's a deep well exploration for gas extraction in the earth. Can be horizontal, can be vertical. Right now, the state of Ohio uses only brine waste, thank you very much, from vertical injection wells or vertical gas wells. So they don't use the stuff that is considered frack waste. That doesn't mean it's not radioactive. That doesn't mean it's any less harmful. It's as harmful as what comes out of any of the gas wells, vertical or horizontal. So brine waste development from oil and gas, it's used as a de-icer on Ohio roads, and it's been that way since 1987. So we've had this stuff around for a long time. Recently, it's been restricted by the Ohio Department of Transportation due to public health risks. I mean, they got it, so they decided they weren't going to buy any more of it, but they do have a large stash of it still to be used on our roads. It's proposed for approval right now as a retail commodity for public sale as an off-the-shelf de-icer, which will avoid regulation of it. If it's a commodity, it doesn't have to be regulated as a public health hazard. This proposed legislation, House Bill 282 and Senate Bill 171, it's currently in the Ohio House and Senate committees. It will permit the retail sale of brine waste de-icer, and it will exempt it from regulations on its use, and it will also exempt it from, for example, tracking, reporting, permitting, and disposal of brine waste from vertical and conventional gas wells. So what this proposal does is allow it to be sold on the shelves of, at Walmart, brine waste. Okay, on the shelf. So you send your kid in or your grandkid in to pick up some sidewalk ice for spreading around, you know, on the sidewalk so you don't slip and fall. It could be radioactive. So the issue for Ohioans, these are, like I mentioned, the two forms of radium. They are bone-seeking isotopes. In other words, they take the place of calcium. They actually substitute for calcium in your body. So if you're exposed to it, your body, it doesn't recognize it as different from calcium. It thinks it is calcium, and so it absorbs it, and it puts it into your bones, and it puts it into your teeth, and it puts it into your skull, your bones. A lot of times the first symptom that people experience with this kind of radiation pollution are our teeth. Teeth cracking, you know, tooth decay, problems with your dental health. The harms to humans, wildlife, the environment, it's there at all levels. Land can be contaminated, crops can be contaminated, mosquitoes, little earthworms, fish, looking at the fish in the sea. And when you were sharing the fish that glow in the dark, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, have they been polluted with brine waste? Well, my little friend here, Rad, Hot Rad, he was in a pumpkin patch in Ohio, and you know, his mom was a huge pumpkin. Huge. And he was just a little runt. So one day, the farmer's coming down the pathway in the garden and looking for a pumpkin to put some pies together for his Thanksgiving table. And he comes across and he picks up Mama, but he kicks Red into the ditch next to the garden. So that winter, it was a hard winter. Lots and lots of snow. The state of Ohio decided to take care of the ice on the road and throw out this brine. So that's where Rad grew up. He grew up in a radioactive stream that was runoff from the road where the brine was spread. That's why he's so hot. Currently, this is not quantified or tracked by the state of Ohio. We don't know where it's gone. We don't know where it's been spread exactly, how much of it has been spread. And Ohio also receives brine waste from other states for a fee. People pay, you know, companies pay the state of Ohio to accept their brine waste. Okay? Thank you very much. It is also water soluble, so that makes it very convenient to spread, to melt ice. But what happens is that it doesn't stay where it was spread. It flows just like water does. Flows into your wells, flows in down through your streams, flows into your fields. We don't know where it flows because it's not tracked. The half-life of these two isotopes is 1600 years. So in 800 years, think about that, these two radioactive isotopes are still around. We're not anymore. We're not sure what's there going to be there, but they are. So that's how long these things last. It's not, this is a forever product that we're using on our roads. This also degrades into radon gas, which is a major contributor to lung cancer. So it's not a very safe product. The biggest problem is that the public doesn't know, though. And there's a lack of legislative oversight for all of this. Just recently, I mean, as of September 30th, the state of Ohio, finally, thank you very much, the Department of Ohio Public Health, the Bureau of Environmental Health and Radiation Protection, I'm so glad there's a department like that, or a bureau, they just developed a report and it's actually based on a study that they did of the amount and length of exposure that people have to radioactive brine in the state of Ohio. And they've determined that it is not safe. In fact, due to increased levels of human exposure to radiation, the use of products derived from oil and gas production brine is not recommended. So they have made their statement. I'm so grateful to them for having done that. I think it's long overdue. But finally, we have some official position from the state of Ohio about its safety. So the health effects of radium exposure. This is a pregnant woman. She's out and about during her pregnancy. She might have a job. She has to get out and drive the roads of Ohio to get to her job. She may go shopping to prepare for her impending delivery. So the routes of exposure that she will experience, one is inhalation. She will breathe the particles that have been thrown up through the dust that occurs after the water dries up. It's oral. It can be eaten, but well, on your hands. People put their hands in their mouth. As well as gastrointestinal, can be on the food that you eat. It can be on your skin. It can contaminate your skin, and oftentimes people develop skin lesions that won't heal, or unusual skin lesions. And then the maternal fetal route. So fetuses can be radiated with this stuff. It crosses the placental barrier, maternal placental barrier. The health effects are systemic. Once it's in your body, it goes all over your body. It doesn't stay in one place. It has immunological effects. So in the era of COVID, it's of high significance. It also has neurological effects, as well as developmental effects. So it's very difficult for children to deal with radioactive poisoning. It also has reproductive effects, down to the DNA level, where it can change the DNA in your body, both for men and for women, as well as for the fetus. It's also genotoxic, and that's that DNA level that I was talking about. It is also carcinogenic. It can cause cancer and death, eventually. So what we're asking people to do, especially people of faith, because people of faith are people of conviction, people with values and morals that are supportive of themselves as well as their community. You were talking about that community that you wanted to preserve. Yes, people of faith come together to help each other. And so we're asking people of faith to act upon the principles of your faith, to stop brine spreading and protect your earthly. We're asking you to take action. So you can do this by raising awareness of your new knowledge with your family. Talk to your family about this. Talk to your friends, your neighbors, your community, your faith leaders. Talk it up. Do your homework. Learn more about the issues and check out the resources online or by phone. I gave you a little handout, and on that handout are some sites that you can go to. The Buckeye Environmental Network has a whole task force that's devoted to this. Stop spreading the radioactive brine. Educate your representatives. Did you know? Guess what I learned? Did you know? So call or write or visit your district and regional reps, your Ohio Natural Resources Committee members. It's also online. I've given you some, I think I gave you some sites that you can go to on the handout. Partner with an organization that's dealing with brine waste issues, like the Buckeye Environmental Network or FACT Ohio. If you want to be on our mailing list and get updates on this, we'll be happy to send them to you. And then go public with your concerns and your knowledge. Write a blog post, put up post to social media. This will be posted on YouTube, as I understand. Record and post a video with what this means to you and to yours. Currently, I believe Dark County, as well as Preble County, are not engaged in the spread of radioactive brine. Each county and its authorities has to give permission to spread this stuff. And I believe that your counties have not given permission to spread this stuff. Maybe they haven't been approached. Maybe they haven't thought of it. Maybe they've decided not to. So find out. Find out what is the position of Dark County about this brine, this radioactive brine stuff. Just by asking the question, write a letter to the editor. That's a good one. How many in here have ever written a letter to the editor? Okay, I think we need a service on how to do an LTA. So the resources to stop radioactive brine spreading in Ohio. These are some nonprofits. Of course, FACT Ohio. We have a full brine education program. We have some grant funding to do that. That's part of what's supporting me here today. The Buckeye Environmental Network. The Ohio Brine Task Force within that network. The Sierra Club also has a focus on brine education. Reimagine Appalachia is another organization that is a collection of states in the Appalachian region that is focusing on environmental stewardship and integrity, and are they concerned about frack waste. Gas and oil development waste. It's not just from fracking, it's from all types of gas and oil development. Anytime you have a deep well that's drilled and it brings back waste products, you've got a problem there with what to do with the waste. UU Justice Ohio is another organization that's working on this. We have monthly programming that we have been doing until the summer, which will hopefully be reactivating, but monthly Zoom programs for you to take advantage of the experts in the field. And then fracktracker.org, they actually have an app that you can download onto your phone or your computer, and that will show you a map of Ohio, West Virginia, Pennsylvania, where these wells are drilled for both the exploration or the development of gas production, the production wells, but then once they're abandoned, they oftentimes turn them into injection wells. And I understand that you all have some experience with injection wells in Dark County. Yeah, not the same product that's going into the ground, but not a healthy product going into the ground. So, this is another really good audio program. Hot fracking. It's called Hot Fracking Mess: How Lack of Regulation Creates Radioactive Waste. And then this particular one is America's Radioactive Secret. And Justin Noble does a nice job of bringing the concerns of workers, of residents, of voters to the forefront in his expose in Rolling Stone magazine. So, governmental organizations, so you've got the nonprofit funded, organization. Then you've got official organizations. Government organizations are the Ohio Department of Natural Resources, Oil and Gas Department of DNR, Ohio Department of Health, and the Ohio Department of Transportation. Any and all of these are organizations that you can call or write to or share your concerns with. I would start with my representatives first. Let them know that you know.
Do you know who our representatives are?
Take action. Do I know who your representatives are?
Yeah, you don't. There's no point in going to our representatives. That's why we're trying to get Melissa in.
I get it. I get it. I understand completely. I'm from West Virginia.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have Joe Manchin.
You can only speak. That's right. We're Joe Manchin.
So this is a class two injection well. Class two injection wells are wells that have been designated as okay to dump brine waste in or other kinds of waste. As you'll notice, the eastern part of the state is littered with these things, as well as the northwestern part of the state, which leaves you right over here. No, yes. Right over here. Yeah. So you've got some of these injection wells in this county, the most prevalent county. And what that does then is, because you've got so many up in this area up in here, this map, by the way, came from Frack Tracker. They do a lot of aerial type of work. And then they plot it on maps so that people can see. But you have the transportation of the frack fluids, the brine waste, from the wells on the eastern part of the state and in Pennsylvania and West Virginia, across the state and then through your county to these injection wells. So it's not that you're not affected by it just because you don't have a lot of injection wells in your county. You are affected if it's running through in trucks, brine trucks. So we would like to promote a what we call a citizen science program, where you take on the responsibility, because nobody else is doing it in Ohio, and that is to monitor, watch the roads, see what's going up and down the road, see what's parked in parking lots in terms of the drilling activity, in terms of the brine waste activity. I live on a country road, literally in the middle of nowhere, but it is a corridor for jumping off of the interstate in West Virginia to the frack fields a couple of counties over. And they rip through my neighborhood at 4 a.m. I can hear them. I can see them. And they're constantly back and forth, these brine trucks. They're supposed to wear radioactive placards on them, but oftentimes they don't. So the takeaway from this presentation, take action. Take action. Someday the earth will weep and she will beg for her life and she will cry with tears of blood. You will make a choice if you will help her or let her die. And when she dies, so will you. And I will be available during coffee hour to answer any questions or any concerns. And I'm going to pass the chocolate bucket around and ask you to think about what can you do? What will you do? Put it on there, pen in here, and you take a chocolate. But just one minute. Do we want to entertain any questions now?
Yeah. Yeah. What is the source of the radioactivity? Does the waste contain it because it's part of the geological structure deep in the earth, and so once that stuff's pumped in, then it mixes in the radioactivity and brings it up? Is that
the waste? They inject millions of gallons of water go into each injection. Pressured injection process, millions of gallons of our water. and it goes into the earth, and it reaches a level where the substances that it's in contact with are radioactive. So but they have to bring that out because it helps to release the gas and the oil. So they release the pressure then with the water, and gas will rise above water, and it releases the gas. They capture the gas. But what, now what do they have to do with the waste? What can they do with the waste? Think that one through. Good question, though.
What's the comparison between the level of radioactivity in fracking fluid and radon that comes up through your basement that you can test for?
Radon is a naturally occurring gas that comes up through cracks and fissures in the earth.
Mm-hmm.
This is higher than what is allowable for radioactive substances in our environment. When I say allowable, what is safe and healthy? It's not that they put any legal limit on it. They can't legally limit what's coming up through your basement, but they can tell you if they do a reading on it, if it's high or low, it's higher than your basement radon.
Because you can put out a test for radon in your basement.
Right, you can.
Mm-hmm. And then you can remediate for that. So if you're getting the fracking residue, I'm assuming if that's in your water supply or in your thing, that would outgas, and the radon test would detect that then?
You can have your water tested. Your water and soil
mm-hmm.
tested, yeah.
Okay.
As well as your air. We're working on with some a company that's hopefully going to produce some inexpensive, less expensive air monitors for people that are in and around the frac fields. Yeah, and the injection wells. Washington County has the highest injection wells in the highest number of injection wells in the state. And they are right on the Ohio River. So playing with fire.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And the conversation will continue after church. And if you tune in to YouTube or the website, I'm sure this is going to continue far beyond today. And as we all know, my suggestion is vote. We know what our legislature has done already with the gun control, and I think we're in the same situation with fracking. So if the Ohio EPA or the study group has studied it and said it's not safe, and the legislature says they're going to let you buy it off the counter, we seem to have a problem here with that. Okay. I'm going to give us a little break here. I was going to do this later, but I think we need a little bit of fun.
Mm.
How many of you know Stella? If you need something, please take something out. signs of autumn and piles of leaves. Chalice, be a branch of the tree of life. This is by Norman Mailer. Our eyes and our minds turn now toward the ordinary. Leaving this space made sacred by our presence, take with you at least some seed of understanding, hope, and courage, and drop it into the confusion of the world. Nourish the seed that it might grow as a tree of life, giving shelter to the weary and hope to the despairing. Be yourself a branch of the tree of life. Amen. Postlude.
This is sticking with the leaf theme. Autumn leaves.
All right. If you missed contact information, contact us and we'll put you in connection with Virginia. She will be staying a little bit after church here and we'll kind of go over some of the information. Remember, the virus is still out there. Wear your mask if you're at Walmart or any place where there's a crowd of people. Dark County has like a 20% vaccination rate. I think I told you the little story about when I got my vaccination for the COVID booster. She said she had 300 shots and didn't know how long those would last. She still has some. All right, I'm going to play the Stella again just because I had so much fun. So go ahead and go back. There's sweets to eat and coffee. And then I'm going to play again the children's story because the camera was, I forgot to point it back here. And for people who are watching on YouTube, I think the pictures on that were pretty cool, so I wanted to see that. So, don't mind the interruption.
Just right now, it's
I know. Well, this is Jackson Wells. She knows the course. What's the name? We're seeing this on your website. We know probably. It's probably brine waste. If they're fostering injections, they are authorized to use brine waste as well as vegetables. So probably brine waste. Chorus yes, it is. It's
thank you. here.
Right, Jordy, she gets to know their husband.
Yeah.
I gave her.